So we're recording now. So the TaxSat software is where one will begin to learn how to file their trust. Obviously, it's a little bit complicated if you've never done this before. So I'll just walk you through real fast, like a speed course. And you don't want to do the freeway. You don't want to do the deluxe. You don't want to do premier. And you definitely do not want to do self-employed. All of those options are incorrect. So what I found is you want to go right here, prepare and file taxes. And you want to scroll all the way down to estates and trusts. So once you go to the estates and trusts, you're going to notice they tell you how to do it online, right? And specifically, we're looking for this form right here, form 1041. It's right there. So this is not the 1040. This is not the 1040. I always reemphasize this. So in order to file a 1041, one must have a document from the IRS, the Treasury, stating that you are required to file a 1041. All right, so that's the first stage of that. And that's usually the trust EIN or an estate EIN. Those are the only two entities one can file a trust or 1041.
Yeah, I have a trust EIN.
Yeah, that's perfect. So anyone that's out there or anyone in the future who sees and views this will understand how to do this in real time online. So next stage would be, obviously, you need to go ahead and start for free. You know what I mean? Like, because they did tell you how much it costs once you get ready to e-file that. But you need to start for free and just get started. So from there, that's when you can learn how to go through the prompts, right? The program shows you how to do it. You got this. We got your back. They telling you. Let's get started. So you go through their prompts. Continue. Then they're going to ask you if you got something from last year you want to import. You know, you're not going to deal with that. So the way I have a course that's set for people who need to get to buy, who need to buy my course, I walk you through on how you can do this the fast, simple way. And that's it. That's all I can say. So in that respect, I'll tell you a few things as we go through. You're going to select simple trust because your trust is supposed to be simple. It's not supposed to be a complex or decedent estate, none of that right now. You're just dealing with a trust. And then they tell you the clues right here. They tell you right there. A trust must qualify as a simple trust if the trust instrument requires that all income must be distributed currently. The trust instrument does not provide any amounts are to be paid, permanently set aside, or used for charitable purposes. And the trust does not distribute amounts allocated to the corpus of the trust. So obviously you want to study that if you don't understand that attorney lingo. So that you know what a simple trust is. Some people are like that. They're very analytical. They want to understand all things. So great. You have your due diligence. But just for illustration purposes, one should just choose simple trust. So you keep going. Then it's going to ask you for the trust name. So that's where the IRS document information comes from. So if you don't have your IRS document, you can no longer go further than this point right here. This is the most required part of most people's situation with the trust. Now, for my illustration purposes, I'll just go ahead and put my trust name. And one of my trust name I have, I'm just going to use, let me use this trust name. What was it? What was the name? I'm going to make sure I got it directly correct. All right, so I can't really find it, so I'm just going to use this one right here for right now. Just for illustration purpose, I'll put Temple Family, the way it's written on my EIN. Then it's going to ask you the fiduciary type. In order to be fiduciary, one has to have a Social Security card or a Social Security number. So that's how you make the fiduciary individual. So you got to have that. That's the fiduciary. So if you want to know what a fiduciary is, you don't know, you never heard that word before. Guess what? They have a clicking part right here. And you can gather all the answers you need of what a fiduciary is, right? So let's look at it. It says a fiduciary is a trustee of a trust. Boom. First thing. Next one. Or an executor, right? An executress, an administrator, administratress, personal representative, or person in possession of property of a decedent's estate. Okay. They give it to you straight right there. So there should be no issues with one knowing what a fiduciary is if they choose to know more. And boom, that's when you put your, like I said earlier, enter the name, the social security number, and the title of the fiduciary. So that's where you're supposed to put your social security card information, right? Because if you don't got a social security card, you can't do nothing. You can't access no trust. So we'll just continue. Then they're going to ask you the address, put the address of the fiduciary, which is supposed to be your apartment or your location where you pay for a lease or you paying rent, right? You don't got to put all that extra what people try to make you do. And this is where it gets to the nitty gritty. Enter the trust federal employer identification number. Employee identification number right here. So if the trust does not have an EIN, it must apply for one on form SS4, application for employer identification number, CIRS publication 583. Starting a business and keeping records for more information. So what the IRS is telling you as a clue that when you create a trust, you're starting a business, right? Right then and there. As soon as you get that IRS SS4 thing and they give you that EIN number, that business is ready to go. So that's the most simplistic part of this that goes over a lot of people's head about businesses and creating a business. So when you get ready to file your taxes, there's no way of separating filing these taxes and having a business and being a business owner or starting a business. So if anybody wants to venture more into that, feel free. Go ahead.
I was going to ask, would it be wise to have like the assumed name as a trust name?
No. It's not even asking that. All the Treasury is asking for is you got to go ahead and apply for that SS4 to start your business. They ain't even say nothing about the state. It says federal employer identification number. So this is how you register your business with the federal government, right?
Right.
So what people do is they try to bring themselves down to the low level of the city, right? I'm going to file my business with the city, right? Or I'm going to file my business with the county, all right? Or I'm going to file my business with the state, which is the main one that most people enter themselves in. And when you register your business with the state, you just gave your business over to the state. Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Yeah, it makes absolute sense because it's telling you right here. It says, if the trust does not have an EIN, it must apply for one on form SS4. Then it talks about C publication. So read more to understand it. I'm not going to click on that right now because that's where people have to venture in, put that time and that effort in. You know what I mean? Starting a business. They're telling you start a business that way and you keep records for your trust. So they're going to see a trust like a business. Then you enter the date the trust was created. We're just going to put for illustration purposes today. Today is January 29th. Many alerts. You have just completed the background session for the trust. Yada, yada, yada. Would you like to correct them now or later? Later. And keep in mind, I'm just walking through the TaxSat software. I ain't got no expert knowledge on filing taxes, right? Ain't nobody have expert knowledge on filing taxes. It's a software that shows you how to do it, walks you right through it. Then they tell you like what type of thing you're doing. It's going to be the final return. We know this is the initial return if you just created the trust. Keep going. Do you need another information? You're just going to go no right now. Do you have to make any estimated tax payments? Nope. Remember, trust don't pay taxes. A trust doesn't pay taxes. We're not going to worry about beneficiaries right now. There's no beneficiaries right now. You're doing a simple trust. Ain't no beneficiary address. All that stuff is just bypass it, bypass it, bypass it, keep going. It's what people get caught up on. They try to figure out every little word and try to see if it applies to you, and it doesn't apply to you. So you start a federal question answer session, and they tell you about your income. Now, this is where it gets to that part where people who've been studying these redemption of you getting your access to your trust and the coupons and the bills, right? The billers, 1099s, right? Canceling the debt. Now, this is the part where I believe, well, I'm going to say I know. I know I'm probably more far ahead than a lot of people on this knowledge because I don't use 1099s. I don't fill it out. I don't have to fill them out. I don't turn them into the IRS. I don't do any of those things. You know why? Because the TaxSat software does it for me. Right? The TaxSat software does it for you. So if you keep going, it's going to show you the 1099s right there. Form 1099. Okay? So let's just go to yes. Just for illustration purposes, I'll go ahead and illustrate for you how I would do it. I was filling out 1099s. Okay, let's see what they say. So they ask you for the interest, 1099, right? Step by step guidance. They're gonna ask you for the payer's name, the payer's tax identification number, or the EIN. So that's when most people get stuck, because if you don't got the information of the biller, the one who sent you the bill, then you really can't even put that EIN information there. So I hope that helps a lot of people with the 1099s, right? Canceling your debt, filing your taxes, because you can't cancel your debt without filing your taxes. You got to file a tax return. So we're just going to say no for right now. Then we're going to go to the next one, business income. I'm going to say no, because I'm not going to put down business income, because I don't need business income there. We'll go no, other income. Right. Yes, you want to put other income because did the trust receive any wages or salary from an employer in 2019? Let's just say no. See what they're saying right now. No. Other income, miscellaneous? No. Unemployment compensation? No. Estate and trust, beneficiary credits? No. Gambling winnings? No. No. See how I'm doing this? I'm really just going through the whole thing so you can kind of get an overview of what you can go back and do. The goal is to try to get through the software. And then if you have to get an understanding on it, go back and just read through and see what it's talking about. So what I did, I had pushed no the first time I got through the software. And after a while, I realized I need to go back and review some stuff. Let me see what I was meaning on capital gains or losses. So I went back. And then lo and behold, I found out this is the 1099B right here, capital gains or losses. And I'm going to show you right here why I know it's a 1099B. Form 8949. Let's review that. And look, it says it right there, form 1099B. Okay? Capital gains transactions. All right? So how would you do this? Once again, you click on that, and you see how I pulled up that same 1099 form again on the software? They're going to show you step by step how you can do it. And then once again, you're going to see, you're going to have a description. See, this is probably the best one that most people can fill out right now. But for illustration purposes, I'm not going to be able to walk you through on this video or anytime at the moment on the 1099B. But just showing you how you can put all your 1099s on your tax return at one time. So you keep going and yada, yada, yada. Let me just get out of here because we're not going to get bogged down on how to fill out a 1099B. We're just trying to walk through to see how we can get through the software to file almost everything we need.
Thanks so much for tax prep.
All right. So as you see, I went through that and went back, you know, to review it because I just quit pushing no. Just go to no. Just if you don't know what's going on, the best thing to do is just say no. Like right here, tax deduction. No. Other deductions. Yes. Did the trust have any other deductions? See, this is where you want to get that. That word deduction is a key word for write-offs. You see? And the only thing they're saying your trust can write off, according to the software, is fiduciary fees, attorney, accountant, and return preparer fees, net operation loss deduction, estate tax deduction, casualty and theft losses. Interesting. So I'm going to click yes. Did the trust pay any fiduciary fees? Yes. What did it pay? Now, this is where it gets kind of simple but complex for a lot of people. Remember, we just went over the Social Security card, or the person who's holding the card is the fiduciary. Okay? So that means that if the fiduciary is managing this trust all year for the year 2019, that fiduciary is going to be paid a salary, right? Or is going to charge the trust for its services. So for illustration purposes, let's just say the fiduciary who managed that trust the whole year did it for about $20,000. We continue. Did the trust attorney accountant pay an attorney or accountant or prepare to file a return? You can say yes. You probably paid some attorney throughout 2019 to do something. So let's just say you paid about maybe $3,000 in attorney fees that whole year for the trust. Did the trust have a net operating loss? I don't know. Deduction? No. Qualified business? I don't know. If I don't know, it's no to me. That's the way it works. No. No. Keep going. So boom, now you can see a deduction example. Like I said, if you want to get more knowledge, you go back and you review it again, right? But as you can see now, we got like fiduciary fees, $20,000. Attorney accountant, $3,000. Then on the bottom, they gave us an exception allowance, $300. Now we're getting somewhere. Distribution to beneficiaries. So we're out. We're out of that. We're not worrying about that. We ain't distributing no beneficiary. We ain't got no beneficiaries yet. Ain't no benefits in the trust yet. You just now starting. So look, now they're giving you a deduction, $23,000. It's like, boom. Now, as you see what I did, all I did was just simply get all the way through the software to examine the entire review of the taxes. Now you can look through all these other things when you feel like. Go back and review it. As you can see, I'm pushing no for everything. I'm not trying to get into that mind-boggling, trying to figure this stuff out, right? Federal refund is zero. Now this is the part where people try to figure out how you get a refund. Then they're going to preview the 1041. Let's go and look at it right quick so y'all can see how it'll look if you was about to print it out and send it to the IRS, right? So the tax software helps you with even printing it out and having a template so you can use for next year. So if you ever had no software, you can fill it out yourself. So paying for it is actually a good thing. Oh, brother said, are you still on? Yeah, I'm still live now recording. So yeah, as you can see, it gives you a review, a full outlook right there. Once you pay these people, right, to use their software, they're going to show you how you can literally print out your tax return and you know, use for next year as a guide. See, this is what this thing is supposed to use when you pay for this stuff, right? It's supposed to guide you through in the future. So I'm at towards the end. I'm just giving y'all the summary of it. You see? So I gave you an example of what I would do for illustration purposes if I was the trustee of the whole trust the whole year. I'm going to charge fiduciary fees to manage that trust the whole year. And I gave y'all for illustration purpose $20,000. And then at $3,000, I had to get some help from some attorneys that's licensed by the bar, right? Or their attorneys in my county or my city. I needed their assistance on sending some documents or, you know, going to court on my behalf, whatever. $3,000 that whole year to manage that trust, to manage that affairs of that trust. So I'm not going to go through a refund because that's for a whole nother video. That's when you start dealing with your 1099s and stuff like that. But for illustration purposes, you all see how I got to that federal tax summary. So feel free if you got any comments or anything you want me to go back over. Like I said, I'm going right back through the tax software. We just went through taxsat.com, and it's a software that walks you through. They even tell you right there in the beginning, welcome to TaxSat. Let's get started. You got this. We've got your back. Right? You ain't got, it's not hard. Use the software. If you don't, you ain't got no complex trust, you don't know all that stuff. Simple trust. Then they tell you right there. Simple trust. Study it. Study the terminology that they're using. Right? What's another thing they got, terminology we went through? We was finding out who is the fiduciary, right? Like I said, for illustration purposes, I just put Temple Family as the trust name. But you're going to go forward, you're going to realize it's going to ask you for a fiduciary of the trust. So, like I said, you know, seeking you shall find, search, click on that fiduciary. They're going to tell you what a fiduciary is. A fiduciary is a trustee of a trust. First thing first. Second thing, or. See, in programming, when I learned programming, or means or, right? An executor, an executress, an administrator, administratress, personal representative. Or, another or right there, right? Person,
we're
person.
We're not on the screen, beloved. We still see the fiduciary type on the Tax Act.
Fiduciary type? Oh, you're not seeing the actual answer center?
No, sir.
Okay. Well, then when you pull up the tax software and you get to that part, click on the fiduciary link because it's probably not going to show on y'all's screen, but it's showing. I'm going to read it out for you, though. It's in the last one, it says, or person in possession of a property of a decedent's estate. Man, they hit us good with that last definition. So I'm going to click out of this and I'm going to go forward. I'm going to show you in the software where the individual is the SSN card. So boom, now they're asking you, enter the name of the social security number, the SSN, and the title of the fiduciary. Remember, they gave you the answer. You need to put that title, and I'm gonna give y'all this answer today. Trustee, that's it. Don't complicate it. Because when the Treasury start asking y'all questions to verify this stuff, they are gonna ask you questions when you file that return. And if you pass the answers, they're gonna send you that refund. So we're going to go forward for illustration purposes. You're going to put your mailing address. Just put your address where you're paying rent at. Right? That's the lease. The fiduciary, right? And then this is the part where we kind of got people banging their head with, like, where do you register? See, this is a federal registration of your business right here. That's why they ask you for the employee ID. Then they give you the answer. If the trust does not have an EIN, it must apply for one on form SS4. Okay? Then you go down here. It says start a business. Starting a business and keeping records. They're giving you clues. They're telling you that as soon as you do this, you have started a business. Then earlier I went over how we give our business over when we go to this lower level, such as the city. Registering your business with the city. You don't need to register your business with the city. Going to the county. You don't need to register with the county. And then last but not least, the big one, registering with the state. You do not have to register it with the state. Why? Because it's a trust. A trust only has to register with the federal, right? That's what it's now. I'm going off of what the instructions say. Not going off my own thoughts. If you want more clarity, it says CIRS publication 583. And then from there, we kept going through the software into the date the trust was created. If you created it today, put it today. And then it goes to the mini alerts. That's when we just kept going to the initial return and so on. So when you start getting to all these questions, I just tell you, if you don't know, just push no. If you don't know, push no. Don't be trying to get all bent out of shape, trying to figure it out. No. You ain't got no beneficiaries? No. Keep going. You don't need no beneficiaries right now for a brand new trust you created. This is for illustration purposes all the way. This has nothing to do with you gaining access to some mystery funds and some trust account. Because there is no mystery fund sitting there. Ain't no Federal Reserve notes just sitting in some bank account waiting for you. That's impossible. It's not there. So if anybody's coming to seek that, I come to tell you bad news that it's not there. All right. This is where it gets to the point where you can get your refunds or your returns. You got to learn how to study that part. I'm not going to show you how to do that. Just for my own purposes, I'm not going to show you how to do that public. You have to get with me privately to show you how to do that part. But that's pretty much it. So if you use the software, it should get you to this point. You got to go back and look at the video that I have recorded. I'm going to post it for us to see it. And it should help you. It's just a technical support for the tax software. That's what I do. I do technical support because I'm a technician. So if anybody got any comments, feel free. Mic is open.
You're going to put it in the group chat?
Yes, the video is going to be in the group chat. It's going to be a public video.
Okay.
Because it's just me walking through with technical support for tax at software for people who have an estate or trust that they have never learned how to file before. So like I say, once you get this, this is a guide for you for the future. So you can use this, Form 1041 template like they give you the preview. And it helps you realize that you can use, like if you had to write it out freehand and you have no software and you have no money to pay them, they're giving you the game right here where you can use this and put it in the right boxes and, you know, figure it out. Okay. That's pretty much it, man. I really can't make it complicated. I know a lot of people have different ways of explaining it, but I'm a technician. I look at stuff from the technician side. So if anybody have any last comments or so, feel free. This recording will probably stop in the next few moments. I'm going to stop
recording. Thank you for joining us.
I'm going to stop the recording right now. So